Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so today we are going to continue with our adrenal gland physiology. Okay, you will be having your MCQ test sometime later, maybe this week. We'll inform you about that. Okay, so today we are going to continue with adrenal gland physiology. In the last class, let me remind you, we had studied about mineralocorticoids and glucocorticoids and all of their mechanism of action, their effects on target tissues, about their regulation, right? So in this class, we are going to continue with that. We are going to talk about zona reticularis and the adrenal androgens, okay, or sex steroids. So we are going to talk about that. And also we are going to talk a little bit about what happens when there is hyperaldosteronism. So we have already studied about aldosterone or mineralocorticoids in the last class, right? So we are going to talk about what will happen if there is an excess secretion of aldosterone. Okay, that is one thing we'll cover. And finally, we'll talk a little bit about adrenal medulla as well in today's class. Okay. So let us begin. One moment. Okay. Right, so are you able to see my slide? Are you able to see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let us talk about adrenal androgens or adrenal sex hormones. Okay. So first, all of you know that they are secreted by zona reticularis, right? Mostly by zona reticularis and in lesser quantities by zona fasciculata. Okay, so what happens is this type of adrenal sex hormones, they begin to appear after birth, okay, at about 5 years of age. And the main products or the most prominent androgen that is secreted by this zona reticularis is known as dehydroepiandrosterone. Okay, that is the most prominent or most active adrenal androgen that is secreted from the zona reticularis. And the onset of adrenal androgen production is known as adrenarche. Okay, adrenarche is the onset of adrenal androgen production. Okay, so most of the hormones that are secreted from zona reticularis are male sex hormones known as androgens, and very little amount, insignificant quantity androgens and progesterones are also secreted. Okay. So these are the basic androgens that are secreted from the adrenal cortex, primarily from zona reticularis and some amount from androstenedione, dione, and finally testosterone. So DHEA or dehydroepiandrosterone is the most active adrenal androgen. Yes, I request everyone drop your mic off. Please turn your mic off. We are having some disturbance. So have all of you muted your mic? Okay, so you are able to see, right? You're able to see this slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so dehydroepiandrosterone or DHEA is the most active and most prominent adrenal androgens. And these androgens in general are responsible for masculine features of the body. However, you should know that actually, their actions are negligible, especially in men. Okay, because testosterone is produced from the testes, as all of you know. And testosterone is primarily responsible for bringing out the male secondary sexual characteristics and all of these masculine features of the body as well. So this adrenal androgens, they do not have much significance. Okay. And however, in women, this adrenal gland contributes to about 50% of circulating active androgens. Now, their role is actually not yet clear. Okay, the physiological role is not yet defined. So you do not need to know in detail about this because it is not clear yet. You should just know that they do not have any significant action on our body. Okay, they are secreted in large quantities from the adrenal cortex, but their role in maintaining physiologic homeostasis is very little. And talking about the most prominent and most active androgen that is secreted, it is dehydroepiandrosterone. Now, what you have to know is what happens when there is some kind of disorder. Okay, so if there is hypersecretion, what is going to happen? So that is more important in this case than the physiological action. Okay, so we will talk about that. Let's go to that. There is something known as adrenogenital syndrome. Right, so I've already mentioned that under normal conditions, adrenal cortex secretes small quantities of androgens, or even if it is more than the cortisol or mineralocorticoids, it does not have any significant effect on sex organs or on sexual function. However, if there is secretion of abnormal quantities of adrenal androgens, this causes development of something known as adrenogenital syndrome. Okay, and some of the androgens, they are converted to testosterone, and testosterone is responsible for the androgenic activity in adrenogenital syndrome. So there is abnormal quantity of adrenal androgens that is being secreted when this syndrome develops. Okay, so this is known as adrenogenital syndrome and it has certain symptoms. Okay, so it is primarily caused due to tumor of zona reticularis cells in adrenal cortex. So all of you know, zona reticularis is the primary zone from which these androgens are secreted. That is why when there is a tumor in the zona reticularis, there is secretion of abnormal quantities of these androgens. Okay, and these result basically result in the tendency for development of secondary sexual character of the opposite sex. Okay, so especially in females, okay, so there is secretion of much amount of androgens and there is conversion of these androgens to testosterone. So there is much quantity of androgens and testosterone that are now circulating in the body. So these will cause some symptoms and bring about some characteristics. So they will cause development of secondary sexual characters of the opposite sex. So talking about females, okay. So when there is this increased secretion of androgens, it causes development of male secondary sexual characters. Okay, this condition is known as adrenal virilism. Adrenal virilism or masculinization, okay. So this causes masculinization due to increased muscular growth. It causes deepening of voice, amenorrhea, enlargement of clitoris, and male type of hair growth. So all of the male secondary sexual characteristics now start to appear in a female. Okay, so there is increased muscular growth. There is deepening of voice, like in case of males. Okay, and the menstruation is stopped, so amenorrhea occurs. Then there is enlargement of clitoris. There is male type of hair growth. So all of these symptoms are seen in females due to this kind of adrenogenital syndrome. Okay, so this is basically primarily due to tumor in the zona reticularis. Okay. So this type of male type of hair growth is seen in the face, even in case of females. This is known as hirsutism. Okay. Now, all of these things result due to this disorder, hypersecretion of adrenal androgens. Okay. Now, talking about another disorder, this is something known as congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Okay, so this is a congenital disorder. It is characterized by increase in the size of adrenal cortex. Okay, so hyperplasia by itself means increase in the size, right? So when there is increase in size of adrenal cortex, this causes this congenital disorder. Now the size increases due to abnormal increase in the number of steroid secreting cortical cells. Okay, so there is a reason for this. Why does this size increase? Okay, there is an increased abnormal increase in the number of steroid secreting cortical cells. Okay, so why does this occur? Okay, so one thing you have to remember is that even though the size of this adrenal cortex increases, the cortisol secretion actually decreases. Okay, so all of you know that cortisol is secreted from the zona fasciculata in the adrenal cortex, right? So you should imagine that when there is an increase in the size of the adrenal cortex, there actually should be increase in the secretion of cortisol as well, right? But no, there is a decrease in the secretion of cortisol. So why does this happen? This is because of the congenital deficiency of the enzymes necessary for the synthesis of cortisol, primarily 21-hydroxylase. So in this case, there is a deficiency in the enzyme, congenital deficiency of the enzyme 21-hydroxylase. So we have already discussed about how cortisol is synthesized, right? So there is a prominent role of this enzyme. So when it is congenitally deficient, then this causes massive decrease in the synthesis of cortisol. Okay, so even though there is hyperplasia in the size of the adrenal gland or adrenal cortex, there is decrease in the production of cortisol. Okay, so one thing you have to remember is that the adrenal androgens, so I talked about adrenal androgens, right? The DHEAs, androstenedione, right? Testosterone. So none of these actually negatively feedback the pituitary gland or the hypothalamus. Okay, so this is quite important. Unlike cortisol or unlike other hormones, these androgens, when they are increased in secretion, they do not negatively feedback the anterior pituitary and do not negatively feedback the hypothalamus. So they do not actually decrease the secretion of adrenocorticotropic hormone from the anterior pituitary. Okay, since they do not negatively feedback the anterior pituitary. So that is why, so you'd know that cortisol goes and negatively feedback the anterior pituitary as well as the hypothalamus, right? So what happens is when cortisol production is decreased due to the deficiency of this enzyme, so the cortisol is not being produced. So due to this deficiency, there is stimulation of the anterior pituitary to release more and more adrenocorticotropic hormone, right, to compensate for this decrease in cortisol synthesis. So when there is decrease in cortisol synthesis, this will obviously cause more release of adrenocorticotropic hormone from anterior pituitary. And what happens is that then this adrenocorticotropic hormone continually stimulates the adrenal cortex, causing hyperplasia of its cells. Okay, hyperplasia of the adrenal cortex occurs due to this continuous stimulation by the hormone adrenocorticotropic hormone. So I'll repeat this once more for you. So there is the deficiency of the enzyme 21-hydroxylase in case of congenital adrenal hyperplasia, right? Due to this deficiency of enzyme 21-hydroxylase, reduced than required. Okay, so this causes stimulation of the anterior pituitary to release more adrenocorticotropic hormone, right? Because the negative feedback mechanism is inhibited due to less production of cortisol. And so when this adrenocorticotropic hormone is produced more and more, this continually stimulates the adrenal cortex and it causes hyperplasia of the adrenal cortex. Okay, so there is even accumulation of lipid droplets in the cortical cells. And this condition, that's why, is also called congenital lipid adrenal hyperplasia. Okay, now what happens is there is continuous, like I told you, there is continuous stimulation of adrenal cortex by adrenocorticotropic hormone. So when there is continuous stimulation, there will be continuous production of androgens, right? So the cortex is stimulated continuously by ACTH. Now, cortisol cannot be formed because of the deficiency of this enzyme, but the androgens are produced more and more. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. The androgens are produced due to continual stimulation of adrenal cortex by adrenocorticotropic hormone. Okay, this results in abnormal amounts of androgens that are circulated in blood again. Okay, because they do not negatively feedback the anterior pituitary or hypothalamus, so there won't be decrease in the secretion of ACTH. Cortisol is continually being produced less and less, so adrenocorticotropic hormone is produced more, and due to this, there is abnormal amounts of androgens that are produced. So is this clear to you, or is there any doubt? Okay, I think this is clear. So this also results in many sexual abnormalities such as virilism. Now let us look at the symptoms, what happens, okay? So the characteristic features of adrenal hypoplasia are virilism and excess body growth. Okay, so in boys, the adrenal hypoplasia produces a condition known as macrogenitosomia praecox. Okay, so the features of this condition are precocious body growth, causing stocky appearance called infant Hercules. So you know Hercules, right? Hercules is a Greek mythological figure who was very strong, very tall, right? And very, maybe he had stocky appearance. So this is known as infant Hercules. And also precocious sexual development with enlarged penis even at the age of 4 years or within the first decade, okay, there is the growth spurt, okay, the growth adolescent growth spurt occurs in the first decade of life. So there is precocious body growth. This causes stocky appearance called infant Hercules. There is precocious sexual development. There is enlargement of penis at a very young age. Okay, so all of these symptoms may be seen due to congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Right? So now what about girls? Okay, so we talked about boys. What happens when this condition is present in boys? Now, what happens to girls? Okay, so in case of girls, the adrenal hyperplasia produces masculinization, like in case of adrenogenital syndrome, right? So this is otherwise called virilism. And in some cases of genetic disorders, the female child is born with external genitalia of the male type. Okay, sometimes even external genitalia is present of the male type in females. Okay, this condition is known as pseudohermaphroditism. Okay, pseudohermaphroditism. So in case of males, we found out that there is precocious growth. There is growth, adolescent growth spurt that occurs in the first decade of life. So there is precocious sexual development as well. This is known as infant Hercules due to this precocious body growth, stocky appearance, etc. Now, in case of females, there is masculinization. This is known as virilism. And sometimes, in case of genetic disorders, the female child is also born with external genitalia of male type. And this condition is known as pseudohermaphroditism. So these two conditions you have to remember when we're talking about androgens, okay, zona reticularis and androgens, since you do not have to concentrate much on the physiological actions because they are not very significant, but many significant disorders may arise due to hypersecretion of these androgens, okay? So remember these two syndromes, okay, adrenogenital syndrome and congenital adrenal hyperplasia when talking about androgens. So is this clear to everyone? I hope it's clear. If there is any doubt, you may speak up. Okay, so I think everything is clear to everyone. Now, let us talk a little bit about hyperaldosteronism. So we have already talked about mineralocorticoids and aldosterone, right, in the previous class. And you've also studied about this renin-angiotensin aldosterone axis, all of the functions of aldosterone when we are talking about CVS or renal system, right? So let us also talk about what happens when this aldosterone is secreted in abnormally large quantities. Okay, so increased secretion of aldosterone is called hyperaldosteronism. Okay, so what are the causes of these hyperaldosteronism? So depending upon the causes, this condition is divided into two types. So there may be two causes due to which hyperaldosteronism occurs. Okay, so one is known as primary hyperaldosteronism. Next is secondary hyperaldosteronism. Okay, so the primary hyperaldosteronism is otherwise known as Kohn's syndrome. Okay, Kohn's syndrome, and it is due to the tumor in zona glomerulosa of adrenal cortex. So the reason or the cause is within the adrenal gland, right? Within the zona glomerulosa of the adrenal gland. Whereas in case of secondary hyperaldosteronism, there are external causes, okay, extra adrenal causes, such as congestive cardiac failure, nephrosis, toxemia of pregnancy, maybe cirrhosis of liver, or some other condition that results in production of more aldosterone than required. Whereas in case of primary hyperaldosteronism, it is basically caused due to tumor within the zona glomerulosa of adrenal cortex. Okay, so it may be of two types, and this primary hyperaldosteronism is known as Kohn's syndrome. Okay. Now, what are the different signs and symptoms of this hyperaldosteronism? So one of them is increase in extracellular fluid and blood volume. All of you know why. We have discussed about the mechanism of action in the previous class as well. Okay, so when there is increased levels of aldosterone, obviously there will be an increase in ECF volume and blood volume. So hypertension is also obvious. This is due to increase in extracellular fluid volume and blood volume. Also, there is severe depletion of potassium, because all of us know this causes secretion of potassium, right? This aldosterone or excretion or secretion of potassium. So what happens is when there is prolonged depletion of potassium, sometimes it can cause renal damage as well. Okay, the kidneys fail to produce concentrated urine, and this may lead to polyuria and polydipsia. Okay, so it may also cause that. And also you can see muscular weakness due to this potassium depletion. And it might cause metabolic alkalosis due to secretion of large amount of hydrogen ions into renal tubules. Okay, so metabolic alkalosis can also be seen in case of hyperaldosteronism. So there is obvious increase in extracellular fluid volume and blood volume. There is hypertension due to increase in this ECF volume and blood volume. There may be severe depletion of potassium, may cause renal damage, and it may also cause polyuria, polydipsia due to inability of kidneys to produce concentrated urine. It may cause muscular weakness due to this potassium depletion, and also metabolic alkalosis due to secretion of large amount of hydrogen ions into the renal tubules. So all of these features may be seen due to hyperaldosteronism. Right, so now there's also something known as escape phenomenon. So what happens in case of primary hyperaldosteronism or this Kohn's syndrome is that edema does not occur in spite of increased ECF volume. So usually when there's increased ECF volume, you can also see edema. But in case of Kohn's disease, Kohn's syndrome or primary hyperaldosteronism, this type of edema is not seen. Okay, this is known as escape phenomenon, and it usually occurs due to pressure diuresis and due to the effect of atrial natriuretic peptide. So we have already talked about how atrial natriuretic peptide inhibits the synthesis of aldosterone, right? It stimulates the G inhibitory protein, and thus it decreases the synthesis of aldosterone. So due to the activation of these things, pressure diuresis and the activation of atrial natriuretic peptide. There is no edema that occurs in primary hyperaldosteronism despite increased extracellular fluid volume. And this phenomenon is known as escape phenomenon because maybe the edema is escaped, right? Known as escape phenomenon. So I hope all of this is clear to you. Right, so we have talked about, first we talked about zona reticularis and about the adrenal androgens. So in case of adrenal androgens, you do not have to concentrate on much else except the conditions of hypersecretion and some congenital disorders like adrenogenital syndrome due to the tumor in zona reticularis or the congenital adrenal hyperplasia that basically occurs due to absence of the enzyme 21 hydroxylase. Right, then we talked a little bit about hyperaldosteronism and its effects. So let us finish up with adrenal cortex and we will begin adrenal medulla. So adrenal medulla is something that you have already, you are familiar with because you have already studied about catecholamines when you were studying autonomic nervous system, right? So actually this adrenal medulla, it is a extension of sympathetic nervous system. Okay. Now, first, before going to the catecholamine synthesis, let us talk a little bit about adrenal medulla. Okay. So adrenomedullary catecholamines or epinephrine and norepinephrine, they're secreted into blood and act as hormones. So this is the basic difference between the catecholamines that are secreted from the sympathetic terminals, postganglionic sympathetic terminals, because they act on the near target organs, right? So they act on certain target organs that are near them. However, in case of adrenal medulla, these adrenomedullary catecholamines, they are released into blood and they act as hormones. Okay, so they don't act as neurotransmitters, they act as hormones. And epinephrine is derived completely from adrenal medulla. So I've already told you the reason as well, right? So there is presence of an enzyme called PNMT in adrenal medulla. That is why norepinephrine is converted to epinephrine in case of adrenal medulla. So epinephrine is derived completely from adrenal medulla, but only about 30% of circulating norepinephrine is derived from adrenal medulla. Okay, so norepinephrine is primarily derived from the sympathetic terminals. Okay, only about 30% is derived from adrenal medulla, whereas the next 70%, it is derived from the sympathetic terminals. So that is why, because this adrenal medulla is not the sole source of catecholamine, it is not actually essential for life. Okay, because catecholamines, the norepinephrine, dopamine, etc. are also produced from the postganglionic sympathetic terminals. Right, only epinephrine is the one that is primarily synthesized from adrenal medulla. So it is not actually extremely essential to life, okay, this adrenal medulla. So let us go to the catecholamine synthesis. Okay, so this is the basic process of synthesis of catecholamine. So as all of you know, it is derived from the amino acid tyrosine. Okay, so first what happens is this tyrosine is transported into chromaffin cell cytoplasm. Okay, so chromaffin cells constitute the adrenal medulla, right? So what happens is first this amino acid tyrosine is transported into the chromaffin cell cytoplasm. Okay, then there is hydroxylation of this tyrosine by the rate limiting enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase. So tyrosine is hydroxylated by tyrosine hydroxylase to form dihydroxyphenylalanine or DOPA, D-O-P-A, DOPA. Dihydroxyphenylalanine. Okay, now this DOPA is converted to dopamine by cytoplasmic enzyme aromatic amino acid decarboxylase. This forms dopamine from dihydroxyphenylalanine. Okay, and this is then transported to a secretory vesicle. Okay, so there are some secretory vesicles that are present. Okay, and these dopamine are then transported into the secretory vesicles, or known as chromaffin granules. Okay, so first there is tyrosine amino acid that is transported into the chromaffin cell cytoplasm. Here it is acted upon by the enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase. This causes hydroxylation of tyrosine into dihydroxyphenylalanine. Okay, and then it is again acted upon by the enzyme aromatic amino acid decarboxylase, which is present in the cytoplasm. It is converted to dopamine, right? This dopamine is then transported into a secretory granule or secretory vesicle known as chromaffin granule. Okay, there it is acted upon by dopamine beta hydroxylase. This is not B, okay, this is beta. Dopamine beta hydroxylase, and it is converted to norepinephrine. Okay, within the chromaffin granule or the secretory vesicle. So norepinephrine is formed now. This norepinephrine, it diffuses out of the chromaffin granules by facilitated transport. Okay, so by facilitated transport mechanism, this norepinephrine diffuses out of the chromaffin granule, and then it is methylated by PNMT. So this is the enzyme that I was talking about. Phenylethanolamine N-methyltransferase, or P. Okay, so this aids in the conversion of norepinephrine to epinephrine. And since this enzyme is only present in the adrenal medulla, it is the primary source of epinephrine, though this norepinephrine can be easily formed in the sympathetic, released by the sympathetic terminals as well. Okay, so this is the process of synthesis of catecholamines. Let me repeat once more. Derived from amino acid tyrosine. So what happens is, first tyrosine is transported to chromaffin cell cytoplasm. Okay, then it is hydroxylated by the enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase and form DOPA. This DOPA is then acted upon by aromatic amino acid decarboxylase present in the cytoplasm. And then this DOPA is converted to dopamine. This dopamine is then converted into dopamine beta hydroxylase. Okay, so before conversion, dopamine is actually transported to the chromaffin granule or secretory vesicle, and it is converted to norepinephrine. Norepinephrine then diffuses out of the chromaffin granule or secretory vesicle and is acted upon by PNMT, and finally epinephrine is formed. Okay, so this is the process of synthesis of the catecholamines. I hope it is clear. Now, talking about mechanism of action, so all of you are aware of the mechanism of action, I hope, because you have already studied the autonomic nervous system. You know about different receptors that are present, right? You know about the adrenergic receptors. So these are basically of alpha and beta variety, right? So the alpha are usually alpha 1 and alpha 2, whereas the beta are beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. So epinephrine and norepinephrine both are potent agonists for alpha receptors and beta 1 and beta 3 receptors. Okay, but epinephrine is more potent than norepinephrine for beta 2 receptors. Okay, for beta 2 receptors, epinephrine is a more prominent or more potent agonist than norepinephrine. Okay, so I hope all of this you can remember. You can go back to Guyton or any other book to learn about what are the effects of these catecholamines on different target organs. Okay, by looking at what receptors are present on those target organs. Okay. So I'm not going to discuss all of that here. Now you should know that there are some differences between epinephrine and norepinephrine. Okay, so in case of cardiac stimulation, epinephrine is more potent than norepinephrine, leading to greater cardiac output by beta stimulation. Okay, then epinephrine is less potent than norepinephrine, or norepinephrine is more potent when we are talking about blood vessels. Okay, so in terms of constriction of blood vessels, norepinephrine is more potent. So this leads to increased peripheral resistance and increased arterial pressure. All of you know the mechanism, right? And epinephrine is again more potent than norepinephrine in terms of increasing metabolism. So these are only a few differences that can be observed. Now, for knowing about the different actions, you have to go to all of the target organs, like what happens to pupil, what happens to the bronchi, what happens to, you know, your heart. All of these are dependent upon the ratio of the receptors that are present there and the types of the adrenergic receptors. So you go to the autonomic nervous system chapter and look at the table. Okay, it's given in Guyton also, I think. So summarizing the effects of epinephrine, so it's not very different from sympathetic stimulation, obviously, because this also aids in the sympathetic stimulation. I mean, coordinates with the sympathetic stimulation. So it gets you ready for fight or flight response. It heightens your senses, tenses your muscles, opens up the breathing passages, etc. So for example, if you're going to fight someone, okay, so you're going to deliver a punch or a kick or something. So at that time, you are very alert, right? So this is heightening your senses. It is tensing your muscles, right? Also, you are breathing heavily. It opens up the breathing passages, etc. So these are the effects of epinephrine. And in response to any kind of stress, it takes less than 30 seconds to kick in and it lasts for several minutes. Okay, so this is a very brief summary when we're talking about epinephrine. Okay, basically it coordinates along with the activation of sympathetic nervous system and gets you ready for a flight or fight response. Okay. Now, what you also have to remember is that the adrenomedullary responses are very rapid. Okay, they are very fast. Why? Because adrenal medulla is directly innervated by autonomic nervous system. Okay, so all of you know now, I had mentioned in the last class also that adrenal medulla, it behaves like a sympathetic ganglion because it is directly innervated by the autonomic nervous system. Okay, that is why the responses, adrenomedullary responses, are also very rapid or very fast. It also involves some centers in the cerebral cortex as well. So cortical influence is also there. That is why some adrenomedullary responses can occur before the onset of actual stress due to the involvement of the cerebral cortex as well. Okay. And adrenomedullary activity, it usually occurs, like I mentioned, in coordination with sympathetic nervous system. But sometimes some stimuli, for example, hypoglycemia, evoke a stronger adrenomedullary response than sympathetic response. Okay, so if you're suffering from hypoglycemia, then actually there is more adrenomedullary response at such a condition, okay, than sympathetic response. Okay. So I hope some physiological actions and effects are clear. Now, again, summarizing these effects. So epinephrine has effects on metabolism, right? So it causes glycogenolysis in liver and skeletal muscle. Okay, so in case of liver and skeletal muscle, it causes glycogenolysis. So this can lead to hyperglycemia. Like I mentioned earlier as well, hypoglycemia is a potent stimulus for adrenomedullary response. Okay, so this causes, the effect of this epinephrine is glycogenolysis in liver and skeletal muscle. Thus, it can lead to hyperglycemia. So there is also mobilization of free fatty acids. That means there is lipolysis in the adipose tissue. Right. There is also increased metabolic rate due to which there is increased oxygen consumption. So these are just some of the effects of epinephrine. So I already mentioned that adrenal medulla is a modified sympathetic ganglion. It is directly innervated by the autonomic nervous system, the preganglionic fibers, and acetylcholine is released, right? And the adrenal medullary cells respond by releasing epinephrine and norepinephrine and dopamine to some extent. Okay, so sympathetic stimulation, it acts in coordination with sympathetic stimulation. So there is catecholamine released into blood. So these travel to both multiple targets and distant targets. So when there is sympathetic stimulation and release of catecholamines from the sympathetic nerve terminals, then they can act on their target cells that are present near them as neurotransmitters, right? Whereas in case of adrenal medulla, when catecholamines are released from adrenal medulla, they travel through blood and reach distant sites and they have their actions. Okay. So let us just look at this. So again, I already mentioned adrenal medulla is a modified sympathetic ganglion. So adrenal cortex is a true endocrine gland, whereas adrenal medulla is a modified sympathetic ganglion. Right. And you can see over here, you also know that there are autonomic influences. The preganglionic sympathetic neuron that goes and innervates the adrenal medullary cells. So there is release of the neurotransmitter acetylcholine, right, to the adrenal medullary cells, and these chromaffin cells or adrenomedullary cells respond by releasing epinephrine, norepinephrine. Okay, and this epinephrine, norepinephrine, it travels through blood and reaches target tissues, which may be distant to the adrenal gland. So don't forget this, okay? Don't forget that adrenal medulla is basically a modified sympathetic ganglion. Okay. So again, summarizing the activity, it's nothing new. It stimulates the flight or fight reaction, increases plasma glucose levels. So you saw that it causes glycogenolysis, right? It increases cardiovascular function, like in case of sympathetic stimulation. It increases metabolic function and it decreases gastrointestinal and genitourinary function. So all of this is like the coordination along with sympathetic nervous system. So all of the actions that are performed by the sympathetic nervous system are also, they are also potentiated, or they are formed in coordination with adrenal medulla. Okay, so all of these activities are performed by catecholamines. Now, exercise is also similar to fight or flight response, right? But without the element of fear. So there is no fear when you're going to exercise. However, your body is undergoing something like a fight or flight response. Okay, but it involves a greater adrenomedullary response than sympathetic response, like in case of hypoglycemia, right? So I also mentioned that in hypoglycemia, more than sympathetic response, there is adrenomedullary response. So it is similar with exercise. Okay, so even when you're exercising, there is a greater adrenomedullary response than sympathetic response in releasing of the catecholamines. Okay, so I hope this is clear to everyone. So if there is any doubt, you may ask, okay. So today we have talked about adrenal androgens. We have talked about what happens when there is abnormal secretion or hypersecretion of these adrenal androgens. We've also talked something about hyperaldosteronism, what happens when there is a increased secretion of aldosterone from the zona glomerulosa. And finally, we have talked a little bit about adrenal medulla. Okay, and if there is any doubt, all of you are welcome to ask. Now, finally, let's also look at the regulatory factors in secretion of catecholamines. So there are many factors which stimulate the secretion of catecholamines. Okay, so it may be trauma, pain, anxiety. It may be hypovolemia. It may be hypoglycemia. Maybe hypothermia. Okay, so all of these factors, they stimulate the sympathetic nervous system, right? So they stimulate sympathetic nervous system, and all of you know by now that adrenal medulla is actually a modified sympathetic ganglion, right? So due to this stimulation of sympathetic nervous system, there is a release of acetylcholine from the preganglionic sympathetic fibers that innervate these chromaffin cells, right? So due to this release of acetylcholine, then there is release of epinephrine and norepinephrine from adrenal medulla, because adrenal medulla is a modified sympathetic ganglion. So this picture can summarize this effect. Okay, so in case of sympathetic ganglion, normal sympathetic ganglion, norepinephrine is released, whereas in case of adrenal medulla, epinephrine is the primary catecholamine that is released, again like I mentioned, due to the presence of enzyme PNMT. So adrenal medulla only has this PNMT enzyme, and it is the sole or the primary source of secretion of epinephrine. Now this epinephrine released from adrenal medulla, it can go to distant target cells and perform its function, unlike the catecholamines released from sympathetic terminus, which can only act on the adjacent sites as neurotransmitters. Okay, so this is about the catecholamines. Now let us also do some simple MCQs at the end of the class, okay, before we leave. So let us do some simple MCQs. Going to the MCQs, let me also talk a little bit about metabolism of catecholamines, okay. So there are two primary enzymes that are involved in the metabolism of catecholamines. They are known as monoamine oxidase, MAO, and COMT, catechol O-methyl transferase. So these two are the primary enzymes that are responsible for metabolizing or degrading the catecholamines. Okay. Whereas in case of this adrenal medulla, this COMT has a more major role to play than MAO. So this COMT, it methylates these catecholamines in non-adrenal tissues like liver. Okay, so basically you don't need to remember everything about this. Just remember that for the metabolism of catecholamines, there are two enzymes that are present. One is known as monoamine oxidase. Another is known as COMT or catechol O-methyl transferase. And these are involved in the degradation of catecholamines. Okay, so this is it for today's class. Now let us do the MCQs, okay? So who should I ask today? I think I'm going to ask Manvi, because Manvi did not answer in the last class. Manvi, are you there? Yes, Manvi. Can you hear me or not? Can all of you hear me? Anyone answer?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so yes, Manvi, ma'am. You are there, Manvi? Okay, I think Manvi is not here. Okay, so I'll ask Rajshree then. Rajshree, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you tell me, what is the most prominent adrenal androgen that is produced from zona reticularis? Is it androstenedione, Dione, DHEA, testosterone, or progesterone?
Ma'am, B.
B. DHEA. Yes, very good, Rajshree. It is the DHEA or dehydroepiandrosterone is the most important and active adrenal androgen. Now, next question goes to Surya Raj. Surya Raj Nisad, are you present?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you tell me, what is the enzyme that catalyzes conversion of epinephrine to norepinephrine?
Okay, N-methyl transferase.
Okay, very good, Surya Raj. So next I'm going to ask Arush. Arush Nigam, are you there? Arush? Okay, Arush is absent. Now I'm going to ask Ishika. Ishika, are you there?
Hello, yes.
Ishika? Okay, Arush is also there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Arush, so you tell me. Adrenal medulla is the primary source of what? Epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine? What is it?
Ma'am, I can see the, ma'am, I am able to see the last question only.
Okay, you aren't able to see this question? What about now?
Ma'am, I am able to see PNMT only, ma'am.
Maybe some problem. So let me just ask you, okay? So adrenal medulla is the primary source of epinephrine, A, epinephrine, B, norepinephrine, or C, dopamine. You tell me. Yes.
Sorry, ma'am. I cannot. I'm not able to get you right now.
Okay, so you should pay attention. Okay, I've mentioned this many times in this class only. So adrenal medulla is the primary source of epinephrine.
Yes,
okay, 80% of epinephrine is formed in adrenal medulla. I mean, all of the epinephrine is formed in adrenal medulla, and adrenal medullary cells form 80% epinephrine, 20 to 30% more epinephrine. Okay.
Now,
the next question goes to this question goes to Ujjwal. Ujjwal Sah. You are there? Ujjwal? Okay, Ujjwal is not there. So Sabal, are you there?
Yes, Sabal, ma'am.
Pandey?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Sabal. So you tell me, epinephrine is more potent agonist than norepinephrine for alpha 1 receptor, alpha 2 receptor, beta 1 or beta 2 receptor?
Beta 2 receptor.
Okay, very good, Sabal. Good, it is beta 2 receptor. And okay, so this is it for today's class. So if any of you have any doubt, you can message me as well, okay? Let us conclude today's class. Let me first download your attendance. Okay. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.